Hi, how you doing, everybody? My name is Jason.
I'm Rachel.
And welcome to Jay
and Ray
PBNJ, comfort food for the soul. And today we're going to talk about something that is dear and true to us, is having faith and believing when things that are ahead of you, things that you may be questioning, and putting your faith in God and just walking in faith and putting Him first. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If you're just curious where we're coming from or what chapter we're coming from, we're looking at Hebrews 11, verse 1 and verse 6. And he says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. But without faith, it is impossible to please Him, for he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him." But reason why we're bringing up faith and walking out and putting your faith in God is something that you have to, I don't know how to explain it, but I guess put your hands out there and put Him first and everything.
Right.
In your family and everything.
So the 20-year-old is getting married.
Right.
Okay. And so we're doing what us parents do, calling around, trying to get arrangements set up, get the venue set, the flowers, the cake, all this. So I call a florist the other day. And actually, I extended an offer to her to come on here at some point in time and talk.
Right.
But that's just one of those things. She's like, she felt the need to share with me that her... she's been called away from the floral business to do God's work.
Right.
So, and it was just very entertaining. Every conversation you have is supposed to begin and end with God, having somewhere in between and all that. And so it's saying you should be able to have a conversation with anybody, anywhere, with any subject, and still be able to bring it back to something biblical.
And sometimes it is scary to walk out in faith and putting God first.
Or you're worried about, oh, somebody's going to judge me.
Right.
Because, oh, I said something about God. It is.
Or Christ. You know, most right. people don't even accept you say, well, God bless you, or have a blessed day.
Some people really like it, though.
Some people like it, but the current environment, I don't understand why it's like that, but it seems like the more and more there's less of God, or the less of Christ, or Yeshua, HaMashiach, the less there is, it seems like the temperament and the what's going on just in the surrounding area. It can be in your local homes. It could be with your family. It doesn't have to necessarily be just globally. But it just seems that there is a less of and more of the negative part that is really bringing a lot of folks down. And I think what's happening is people trying to find a way to get involved in something that they believe in.
Okay, well, you're going to get irritated with me on this probably, but here we go.
Okay.
So we're getting into that season.
Okay, getting into the season.
And it's the holiday season. And it's not what anybody should really be participating in and being overly...
Well,
okay.
I think there's a reason why it happened that way.
So then you have a bunch of people look at the Christian community, and we're all literate. We can read, mm-hmm. and there's so much information out there anymore. Literally, you pick up your cell phone, you can find everything you need to know. And so they know what's wrong. They see everybody practicing what's wrong, and then go, religion doesn't even make sense at this point.
Well, most people don't. Well, most people see religion as, well, Sunday I'm going to go to church and I'm going to pay my tithe and I'm going to go to whatever favorite restaurant that I like to eat at with my family, and I'm going to go home, and then after that it's just,
we're done until next Sunday.
We're done until next Sunday. And
maybe Wednesday night church. Thursday night men's group. Yeah.
Or a women's group or Bible study.
Yeah.
But that's different from church to church, and some people don't even do that. And so I think... what the message is saying, now faith is a substance of things to hope for. So if you have faith, without faith, how are you going to incorporate God when most don't even incorporate anything? And I think the most dangerous person is one that don't believe in nothing.
Yes. Now that I have, yes. We won't talk about our kids too much, but I'll say, so when they get involved with somebody that has no faith in anything, I'd almost rather them be, I don't know, pick a religion.
Right.
Pick something. And I'd almost rather you believe in that, because then at least you had faith in something. And there is something there to where I feel like we could move on. But when you have faith in nothing,
it makes it...
It's really scary.
Very scary.
You have to have a lot of faith to have faith in nothing. And think about that, though. You think that everything happened, and that's it. This is just us. That takes a lot of faith to just think this just happened and this is it. Well, there was nothing in the vastness of just how our bodies are made up, how our minds are made up. I'm not even talking about anything else on the planet. I'm just talking about people, how intricate we are to think that that just happened by chance.
But that's why the Bible says in the beginning, the world was without form. And if you can...
100%. And I was going to say, and then you got the people I'm sitting thinking, you can't... Science lines up with what the Bible already told us. The exact creation of how they think that animals came onto this planet.
Right.
And starting with the sea life first, and then we got birds, then we got some animals, and then we got people.
I think that's Genesis, what she's talking about. But anyway,
pretty certain it is. So it's interesting that it said that out there, but still, that's not enough to even go, wow.
Well, I think
that to me is enough.
The amazing piece is to take something without form and to create something into or manifest something that is very dynamic and above normal, I guess you say. You know, it's a level that we can't even comprehend.
I was supposed to say my brain is too small to think of something outside of our time and space.
Right.
Like I don't have enough brain power for that.
Well, time.
Because time, space, and matter do not matter to God. He is outside of that.
One day equals 1,000, you know, or one day could be a year. Time doesn't matter to God. And
well, because time is a construct made by man, because we have to have markers. But still, there's got to be a beginning to something, but he's outside of the beginning.
Right. He's at another. Here we are, and God's like.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. Like, my mind
can't. Mine can't even fathom, but by faith, you know, God knew and already knew what He had planned before He even had planned. Like when God says, "I know you by the numbers of your hair," which I'm bald. He still knows.
You're shaved.
He knows. He knows every strand, every DNA, every atom, every molecule, you know, and he has faith that you're going to do what he's going to ask you to do. And when he says without substance, because you got to have substance. So faith without substance, if you don't have the substance to just move forward, just to step out like the floors, just step out and just let God, just let God take over. It's for some folks, it's hard to even fathom that kind of, even though that thought.
Well, you're not going to have that thought unless that thought is given to you.
Right.
Okay, so there's just that right there.
Is that my subconscious? Is that like little whisper thing?
Or? Oh, you can say that. It's right. Your little inner man.
Inner person?
Your inner man.
Oh, my inner man? Oh.
I'm trying to speak to your conscious saying, hey, just go. But you have to have somebody who, well, I won't even say that. That's not even right either. I say somebody that's looking for it, but you don't necessarily
have to
be looking.
You gotta pray.
No. I'm pretty sure that there's been people that's just been smacked with it one day, just woke up and was like, wait.
You know what? I'm gonna do this.
Yeah. It's like, I'm on the wrong side of the road. I need to be over here when I was over here.
Right.
They just wake up and they're like, what? No. So it happens.
And it happens that way.
But if you want to keep it,
right,
you gotta keep in it.
Well, as long as you stay
keep it around you.
And stay, I don't know, spiritual filled or God filled, or what's the word I'm looking for? You know, our situation, it was a few years back, and our child, our daughter, Rachel can tell you how she was when we was at the daycare center.
Oh, yeah.
And the experience she was having at the daycare center.
This lasted 3 days. That's all the longer it took.
Yes.
And I would be praying on my way to drop her off and crying in the parking lot, and she'd have to pull her off of me.
She was almost lethargic.
I got her home, she was so tired and exhausted because she didn't eat all day. She didn't sleep. She didn't, you know. And she was just pitiful and tired, and she would just sleep almost from the time we got home, and she would cling to us, and she didn't want to be in her own bed. She didn't want to be away from us. And on the third day, I called you from the parking lot crying after dropping her off before I could go to work, and you're just like, quit.
I just told her to quit her job. Yeah.
Said, well, I'll figure it out.
I'll figure it out. And you know what? God has been, you know, that's a version of leap of faith. Just sometimes you just, you know, just let go and let God just take over.
Yeah. We're definitely a two-income, tight household.
Very. But in this situation, I believe God is continuing to reward. Remember that when I was talking about substance, he says, when we talked about 11:6, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. So if you don't have faith, how are you going to be able to step out of your comfort zone and just go for it? Just go for it. Mm-hmm. Because whatever happens, you know, when he said in the beginning, the earth, things would, well, I don't want to make sure. I want to make sure I tell you exactly what he says, because I want to paraphrase. I could paraphrase, but he says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth was without form and void. So you stepping out there, the safety net is God. The safety net is Christ in your heart. The safety net that you're looking for, sometimes you can't see it. And faith, you know, going out there, you got to believe that he's got you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he's got us. He's got our family. You know, even with the temperament, what's going on right now, sometimes you're just going to have to pause. Because everything the noise that's going on, everything's in your ear. You're trying to make the right decisions, and sometimes you just got to pause and go, I'm gonna have to wait for it before I jump out there, and let other entities get involved in our lives. And so if you're not letting God encompass you, then I don't know. But then again, if God is speaking to your heart to do certain things, then that's what he's doing. But for us, he told us, hold up, wait. This may not be the best thing for you to do.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes, you know, that little, what they call it, that little whisper, that thing goes, hey, I think you're better off. You better wait. And that even happens when you're driving a car. That happens when you, like, sometimes you could have, like, stopped and then something just fell right there in front of your feet.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you don't know why you stopped. And it happened.
I was going to say, went to Paducah 3 weekends almost in a row, it seemed like, and missed a wreck every weekend by minutes.
By minutes?
Yeah.
Can happen.
And it was because we got held up. Me and a girlfriend of mine got held up doing something. Ended up looking at something a little bit longer. Said, oh, let's stop over at this store before we head home, or let's stop here and get a drink. I think let's go get Starbucks.
Right.
You know, kind of a thing. And then get on the interstate, and we're like, all right, there was just a major wreck in front of us.
And sometimes God works like that.
Mm-hmm.
And for that substance, God is the substance.
Mm-hmm.
You just got to believe that. And if you're seeking for something, just put God in it. When you begin it, start and end. Your conversation should be fruitful. When you talk and we talk about God in our lives, we incorporate God in everything we do.
Well, yeah, other thing is because you keep reading, you'll read something new, I'll say, and that can be your conversation starter or work it into what you're doing for the day. There's great apps you can get on your phone right now that give you like the verse of the day. You know, that's enough to get you reading a little bit of something and keeping you going with it. Not saying that you stop with just that verse, you know, go ahead and read a little extra, but that would keep you a little bit more fresh in having it with you. Nothing as good as turning the pages of a book, but like I said, apps make things pretty convenient for people who are on the go now.
So, I'm something that just came to me, and I just want to think about how I'm going to say it. So I experienced something a couple of days ago, something that I felt that there was something missing. Substance was missing. And so, and I was looking, I was asking Rachel, I was looking for something when you go in something that's dead, you know, like it could be a church, it could be a building, and you just, it just feels dead. So I just want to share this. This is Hebrews, still in Hebrews. And it's 10 and 11. And every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifice, which can never take away sins. That's a lot. So think about what I just said. There's a lot of people who may think they're called to do what they're supposed to do, offering the same piece of meat, and you're not getting filled with the Holy Ghost. You're not getting filled with what God is providing for you. You're looking for something that God is asking you to do, but the person who's supposed to guide you may be misguiding you and leading you not towards God, but away from God. It just made sense. I was looking for something. I was looking for something. We're talking about drought, talking about,
like, you know, when you go to a church and things feel like they're staged.
It feels staged.
Like it's a performance.
It feels like a performance. It doesn't feel real. It just feels like I'm just trying to show out.
Or you feel completely disconnected. You feel from what's disconnected. Going on around
you. And I was looking for it. I want to thank God right now. Thank you. I was looking for something that can give me or give us what I was looking for. And that is what I'm experiencing. People are looking for substance. People are looking for substance. You may say, well, maybe I'm not looking for substance. I guarantee somewhere in your body, you're looking for substance. You can drink water and still be thirsty. You can eat and still be hungry. God and Christ says, I am the river of life. You know, you drink, you come to me, I'll fill you up. I'll fill your cup. Your cup runs over.
Mm-hmm.
So I was looking for something that would give that answer for whoever's watching this. It could be 100% for us later down the road. But
yeah,
if you're looking for substance, faith. You got to have faith to have substance. You got to have God to have substance. If the priest that standeth daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifice, the same plug and play, and not giving you meat, all you getting is stale bread. All you getting is rotten. You're just getting rotten stuff. And sometimes you just got, like what Ray says, you just got to get back in the Word. And you're just going to have to read it for yourself. There's a lot of folks that go to different organizations. Don't want to point out. Don't want to name.
Nope.
They've never made it past Revelations.
What do you mean?
I can't tell you who it is, because then whoever watching it might think that I'm talking about their
No, I'm just saying. Never made it past Revelations. Like, that's the only book they preach out of?
No. They may preach out of the New Testament. They may hit and miss out of the Old, but they will never talk about Revelations.
Oh, never talk about it.
Never talk
about it. Oh, I thought you meant that was the only thing they preach. I'm like, well, that's the end.
No. Never talk about it.
Well, okay, there's that too.
You know, and...
And if you want to get into the hierarchy of the Bible and its lineage and how things were taken apart and stuff like that, that is something that Martin Luther wanted to take out too, was Revelations and James.
Yeah.
So, I mean, so that's not unheard of. So that's where, okay, so that opens another little thing. So okay. That's where you get your denominations at and how they practice and stuff like that, how you can have everybody that's supposed to be reading the same book getting the same information.
But then they just skimming it.
No, I'm saying they're all divided. Okay, that's what I was going with.
Right.
So you have Catholics, and then you have...
Protestants.
The Protestants, which is your Baptist, Lutheran, Methodist, Pentecostal, Church of Christ.
You have a...
Mormons.
A conglomerate.
Okay, but yes. They can't all get on the same page either. They can get close, but it's almost like we're reading two different books. That's what you're talking about, how some people...
Right.
Don't ever go into Revelations. Well, that would be one of them groups that I just listed there would shy away from it. Now, why is that?
Because I think it's afraid. It's almost like fear. Like, I'm afraid to...
Spoil the ending for you?
Not to spoil the ending. I mean...
I'm playing.
Maybe...
I've been to churches where that's all it feels like they preach on is Revelation, and the end is coming tomorrow. It's game on.
But Christ says the end will come. You hear about it. But don't worry about it, because you know what? If you live your life as every day is the end, when are you gonna live?
Okay, but you could also say if you live your life like every day is the end, then you should be living a proper life, because okay. This is your last day, so you should be upright.
You should be happy.
But people take that the other way, and if you live like you're dying, then they're gonna be doing all craziness. But that's not what you're supposed to do.
And that's why there's faith.
Yeah.
Faith. Substance. Now,
if I wake up tomorrow, I'm going to be in a better place, so it's okay.
And some people don't believe that. Some people are so afraid of just talking about death, because death is something that the Bible talks about all the time.
Mm-hmm.
That they'd rather live for eternity in some AI robot type of deal, yeah. You know. But that's a whole nother subject that we're going to talk about. But another one that kind of came to my mind and I wanted to talk about also was about the Holy Ghost, which also falls in the Hebrews, which also falls under 10. I'm going to read this right quick. Whereof the Holy Ghost also is the witness to us. For after that he had said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts and in their minds, and I will write them. And their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. So what he's saying is, I'm gonna give you the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. Because you have faith, because you put me first, I'm going to give you the Holy Ghost. I'm going to fill you up. And as you continue to walk in God's path, he's looking at everything you did in the past. He says, hey, check this out. I'm going to make a covenant with you, brother, sister. You're doing what I'm asking you to do. Now, you know, just like David did some things that he wasn't too happy about. And ended up, and actually went pretty the wrong way, sending somebody out to war to get with somebody else. Now, God saw favor still in David. Am I right? You tell me if I'm wrong.
Yeah.
He still saw favor. He still was king, but he did something that he wasn't supposed to do.
Way to put that, just really gloss over. He did a no-no.
He did a no-no. You tell, if you want to go ahead, give him the apples.
Sent a married woman's husband to be killed in the front lines of a war so he could have his way with her, essentially. And while he did that, while her husband was out there being slaughtered, she did conceive one child and lost it. Well, it died afterwards.
Right.
Then they got married. He rectified, repented of his sins, and then they had Solomon.
Booyah.
So, no, there's definitely, you know, I mean...
These things happen. I mean,
these things happen.
These things happen. I mean, but I mean.
No, these things shouldn't happen.
Shouldn't happen, but they happen. They happen.
I think the point you're trying to make is that just because you're an imperfect person doesn't mean that you cannot stop doing those imperfect things and then become a better person.
And that's what Christ was saying to the woman.
Yes. So when Jesus died, that's when we got the Holy Spirit, when all these things got written on our hearts so we would know better.
Yes.
You know better jumping out the gate, you should know better. Like, even kids that aren't brought up in a church, you know, into young adults and stuff like that, you have a feeling in there that things are right, and some things are right and some things are wrong. You just know that. Our whole moral codes written as society are based off of that too, of right and wrong. Well, where do you get right and wrong from? You get it from the Bible.
But if I don't know anything about the Bible, somebody's going to have to just...
Yeah, somebody's going to have to tell you, yeah. Yes. I'll say, working with a girl that... And I would have thought that everybody in this point in time, and in America at least, you know, had heard about Jesus and God and the plan of salvation.
And I think she says, how can she not go to hell?
Yes, she came up to me one day at work. She's like, I just want to know. She's like, I don't want to go to hell. Yep. How do I not do that? And I was totally floored by it because she's 24 years old, had kids of her own.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't believe it. I was like, okay, well, it's a great opportunity. Let's go. But that exists. And we're in a small community. Like, there's 800 people here and 6 churches.
Well, all of a sudden they started popping up, but just within the last couple of years. But yes,
okay. Growing up, I know there was at least 3 in Owen. There was the Baptist Church, the Methodist Church,
right,
and the Catholic Church, and that was in town. Then you had Cash Chapel out here.
Right.
There was 2 in Parks.
Okay.
Which has got less people. There's, I know, the Pentecostal Church in Olmsted.
There's one in Grand Chain.
Yeah, see, okay. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. No, they're all over the place.
They're small, like little, you know, maybe congregations, maybe 10.
No. We had max capacity in our church at 150 people. So. Well,
my church was, we were small. We were small gatherings.
We had a quarter of the time.
We were some Bible thumpers.
No, on a good Sunday, I think we had maybe like 40 people there.
And I was the head musician trying to ding 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 ding. You know. But anyway, getting a little off track.
No.
The whole reason why we was talking about substance is, if you're looking for substance, you gotta have God. If you're gonna have God, you gotta have Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And you're gonna have to pray. Communicate with God. You gotta go in your prayer space. Having that conversation with Him, and asking Him not only when you are in trouble, because it seems like when everybody's in trouble, oh God, help me, please. No, mm-hmm. You gotta have conversations before you even get to that level. You gotta have a relationship. If you don't have a relationship, how are you supposed to communicate?
It'd be like, say you haven't talked to your parents in 3 years, and then you needed some help because, like, I don't know, your car broke down or something, or you're getting thrown out of your house. There you go.
Yep.
So you're gonna call your dad and be like, "Hey, Dad, so like, can't?" And he's gonna be like, "Oh, I ain't heard from you in a hot minute.
Yeah,
so we're gonna take a couple of minutes here to get reacquainted.
Let's pause for a second.
And I don't know that I could do this right away, and
you know,
kind of thing, because we haven't talked. That's how I would equate it.
Wait a minute.
Our Father,
who art in heaven.
Yes. I'm just saying, our Father, just like, you know, you have to have a relationship. And you'd be like, oh, well, He doesn't talk back. Sure He does.
No, and what God has always said, it's pretty much by a whisper. He doesn't always come dramatically, you know, thunder or some crazy off-the-wall rain or hurricane. I mean, He does do things very dramatic. He'll smite you right there. But
all right now, we ain't talking about like Moses and Aaron up a hill.
He smited everybody, and Moses said no.
But anyway, that's not what I was going to say. No, He stopped doing things so loudly like that because back then it was just God trying to talk to individual people, right?
Right.
And it just wasn't working. Like, I'm going to talk to you, and you go tell these people to go do this.
And they were His antenna.
Right, and they were trying to help everybody listen, and He would make big grand gestures. Like, I think 7 plagues would have caught my attention. The first one would have got me good. The second one, by the 7th one, I'd be like, I'm in it to win it now. I 100% am down for this. But so he stopped doing that after Jesus came, and he gave us something better than a big shiny sign in the sky, which was the Holy Spirit.
Right.
So you don't have to look so hard or think so hard or however you want to say it. It should be here.
And to seek God, you don't have to go a million miles away, like somebody I know, to find God. Me, when I went to Turkey.
Oh, I was like, what are you talking about? I'm like, who went a million miles away?
A million miles away. But the experience.
And you didn't have to go. You wanted to go.
Well, yeah, that's true.
Okay, thank you.
But the experience alone is God is right here where you are.
Wherever you are.
Wherever you are. In your situation you're in. Mm-hmm. Each person's situation is different. Mm-hmm. Born of the same woman and will die in the same manner, either that's in the ground or... Mm-hmm. Or cremate it, but you don't want.
If you're going through a really, really hard time, that might just be God trying to get your attention. That's the big sign he's doing today is I'm gonna
shake
make
you.
Things a little bit hard for you.
I'm gonna shake you.
You know, there's that thing where you know how people say, oh, God will never give you more than you can handle.
Right.
Well, that's a fib. Of course he will. How else would he get your attention?
Sometimes.
Because you're gonna sit there and think, oh, I can do this. And that's not it, no.
Because did you ask God?
You can't do it by yourself. God is going to give you more than you can handle because you're supposed to give that to him.
Yeah.
You're not supposed to be like, oh, I got this. No. Okay, you can get a few things, but the really big stuff, all your worries, your troubles, your this, that, and the other, and your good things too, but those kind of burdens, you're supposed to give that to him.
Right.
And that in that instance, and I don't like, remember the scripture, like, they will bring God is closer to you then than he is any other time, is when you need comfort.
And if you're looking for comfort, sometimes you just got to stop where you are and just say, Lord, look, I have reached the bottom of the barrel and I'm there. Sometimes you're just going to have to just lay it all out, mm-hmm. and just say, God, you know, forgive me of my sins.
Forgive me of whatever it is that I didn't know I did or what I'm doing. I'm trying to figure this out.
Maybe I tripped up. Maybe I fell short somewhere. I don't know. Maybe I went off the wrong path. Maybe I'm supposed to go this way, but I end up over here. You know, it's sometimes it doesn't have to get to the point where someone's trying to take your life. It doesn't have to get to the point.
You went off the deep end. I was talking about bad financial moves.
But sometimes, help.
Like I'm about to get kicked out of my apartment. Not that people are coming after me with steaks and knives.
Well, but see, this is a different situation. Some people, you know, may had a real bad deal, whatever that deal may be. It doesn't have, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And you know, you got caught up in some things, and oh my God, now I'm in this situation, and you know, and you're trying to get out of it. I mean, everything's happened every day. Every day there's something happening.
Be honest, confess it,
and just
repent of it.
And sometimes
ask God for help, and you'll be helped.
Sometimes you got to be like Daniel. You know, Daniel's in that pit, and them lions around you. Sometimes you're just gonna have to just like woosah. You know, woo 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 woo. You know, just chill and just like, Lord, I'm sorry.
Well, and in that instance, he absolutely knew there was no way he could physically fight a lion.
No, or tiger.
So that's why I go back to saying when people say, God will never give you more than you can handle, I'm pretty sure a den of lions is more than any of us could handle. And it was only through his faith with God.
Faith with substance.
That he survived that.
And we ain't talking about let them eat cake either. No, we're talking about substance. God fearing, God filling, God anointing, God healing, God blessing. That all, whatever you want to call God, you know, some people call him Allah, some people call him Yahshua HaMashiach, Elohim, whatever you call, God is right here. I mean, he's like right there. Sometimes you gotta unclench this right here and just Let go and let God. Mm-hmm. And back to what I was saying earlier. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you're not going to see everything happen. You just got faith. Sometimes it may take a day. It may take a year. But don't give up.
Well, the other thing to be said too is you might be really hopeful and really wanting this thing over here to happen, but that's not what's best for you.
Maybe it wasn't caught, you know. Maybe it wasn't supposed to be a track star.
Yeah, it definitely was not. but yeah, it's along those
basketball
lines.
Player. I don't know. Mm-hmm. Sportsman.
I'm 5'4". I don't think that was ever happening either.
No big time rapper. No. Sometimes you may be called to be the best janitor of some school. Sometimes you may
Because you don't know why you're in that janitorial role, because it might not be just because you can clean
floors
like a
beast. You may have to witness to somebody.
That's what I say. You don't know who you're going to be the Christ for in that school.
Right.
Who's going to need that smile for even simple stuff, that smile from you that day, that always shining personality. The hug in the morning, somebody that remembered to give you a Kleenex when you needed it. You know, that's how you're the Christ for people.
That's why I believe that's why we... See, this is why I'm feeling it. I'm feeling it. Look, I'm telling you.
Okay.
It your calling may be not as extreme you're thinking you need to be. Sometimes...
I need to be the head neurosurgeon at the Mayo Clinic?
No. Yeah.
No.
You know, maybe sometimes you could be that farmer on that's out there in the field that's picking up bell peppers and cucumbers and squash, whatever, you know. But that exact moment was somebody that needed to hear that God loves you. That there is someone out there that want to be involved in your life. There is someone out there that knows you're struggling, that knows you are hurting with inside, yet you got pain. Just because you fall don't mean you can't get back up. Just because you scrape your knee just don't mean you can't heal. You know, I was thinking about what my mom talked about. She's talking about healing. It's not that healing be death. I mean, that's a little bit extreme for, you know, getting to that level of healing. But sometimes healing comes in different forms and different shapes. On that note, our dog's telling us it's time to go.
I kind of.
Just remember, without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder. Just remember, he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Doesn't necessarily mean on this plane.
No, not on this plane.
I know you're trying to end it. I'm sorry.
I know. My wife's so funny.
Just so you know, your rewards may not be what you're thinking here. Oh, I don't want you sitting there, people sitting there thinking, well, if I pray and I do all this stuff, then I'm supposed to get, like, you know, a mansion here and, you know, a Maserati and whatever. That's
no,
not what it is.
No, it's not that, no.
Your reward is not here, because here is a very small space in the grand scheme of things.
And your reward could be...
It should be. The only reward you should be working for is in heaven.
Right. Working on your treasures in heaven.
Yes.
Working for that mansion that Christ talked
about.
Well,
that and quit acting like a child. Like, I only work on a reward system, too, anyway.
Right. Sometimes your rewards could be less. That's true.
I'm like, do you want to get into the Jesus parables here with the talents and stuff?
I mean,
10, 5, this 1. This is what happens.
You plant this, you get this. You save
you
this,
great.
You can get this. And this guy used this. This guy, you know.
So the thing was to go out and sow and reap what you sow, not to sit and hide. But when you talk about you'll be rewarded, I don't think that God necessarily means that you're going to be rewarded with riches and glories here, because what does he care about here? Here's temporary.
Here's temporary and
there is forever.
There is
so
forever.
Your glories,
and you should be working
your riches
on
should be there.
on what God has called you to do, and that is to be with Him. You know, there's a lot of room in hell.
There's a lot of room in heaven. I'm pretty sure there are infinite amounts of space in both places.
I'm sure there is, but you got to figure out which way you want to go, and both have its own cater. And so I want to just say, just be diligent. Just look for God. Look at God. Look to God. Ask God. Have faith. Fall in love with God.
Just fall in love.
Or just fall in love. You know?
He's usually in the middle of it.
He's usually in the middle of it. And he said, without love.
Without love what?
Well, you can't have the covenant. The covenant was up without love.
Okay. It is late.
Well, I appreciate y'all sticking with us. I hope you enjoyed. And thank you for tuning to Jay and Rae.
PBNJ.
Comfort food for the soul. And wherever you are, good morning, good night, good afternoon. And
we'll try this again.
We'll try this again, and we'll shoot another one out. Have a nice day.
Good night.
Good night. I've done what you've done. I am creator of time. I'm joy and never your pain. You know who